Our goal here, we're dedicated here to support our members in fulfilling their mission through our programming, our daily wellness classes, our Ayurvedic food, and our community. We have three buildings total, and one will be opening up in about 2 weeks, and we have another one opening hopefully by the end of the year. That location is in Vida, it's 17 John Street. And then we are also excited tonight to be able to host one of our members, that is one of our current members, Daniel and Peter, for their talk tonight. And my name is Shafkat, by the way. I didn't even introduce myself. this is my first time talking in front of so many people. So I just want to introduce myself. I'm part of the sales team here, and I wanted to take the time to introduce everyone that hasn't been here before, even for the people who have. If you have any questions about becoming a member here, or if you want to learn more about our co-working spaces or our co-living spaces, the information will be at the front desk on your way out tonight. So if you have any questions, feel free to send us an email or give us a ring, and we'll be more than welcome to help you. Okay? All right. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Yeah. So thanks so much to the assemblage for hosting this event. And we're actually live casting it on Facebook, so if you have friends who would love to see it, you can share it from Facebook, as we just did. And I'm really happy to be here with Peter Joseph, whose work is really an inspiration. I don't know how many people here have seen the Zeitgeist films. I mean, they had such a cultural impact, and then he followed that up with creating the Zeitgeist Movement, kind of turning ideas into you know, community practices, getting people around the world engaged. And then I was kind of wondering where he was at. And then he sent me his most recent book, The New Human Rights Movement, which I found incredibly fascinating. And I think is a really important contribution to the dialogues and conversations that we really need to be having right now. So thanks so much, Peter, for making the time to be with us.
Thank you, Daniel. I really appreciate this event and everyone that put it on, and look forward to this chat.
So what, you want to talk a little bit about, maybe go back to Zeitgeist. I'm kind of curious what's kind of been your trajectory since doing those films and the impact they created?
Altered and deviating and spiraling. That film was made as an artistic expression. So what that means is I had no intention of actually releasing it. So there's a unique serendipitous quality to the way everything kind of played out, as I had no interest or no intent to go in and be a filmmaker. So when that film came out...
You were working in advertising back then.
And Wall Street. So I've had the benefit, if you can believe that, of being in two of the worst kinds of socially created economic environments on the planet, because these are the two most... corrupted and poorly value-oriented industries on the planet, advertising at Wall Street. They don't do anything. Anyway, so that was kind of where I was just trying to survive. I was a musician, though, so I had some genuine nature to me. It wasn't, a lot of people in the arts end up in advertising, because that's...
Heavy metal, or...
What's that?
Heavy metal?
Well, I was actually a classical percussionist, so I was intended to be a orchestral percussionist, but that was a little too cold for me, so my 20th century modern music interest led me to more personal things that would never make a career out of. So, I mean, I had to moonlight and other things, so with advertising, and then want to get out of advertising because I hated it, so I went into Wall Street as a private day trader. And then in 2007, I had a catharsis moment, made Zeitgeist at a performance piece, Lower Manhattan, and it exploded, went viral on the internet before viral was even a thing. This was before YouTube. Well, there was YouTube, but you only had 10-minute cat videos at that point. And from that moment on, I made a second film, Zeitgeist Addendum. My point being, I had a responsibility at that point. So Zeitgeist was a fleeting thing, you know. It wasn't like I said, you know, there's a lot of criticism of that movie. And with good reason, because if you look at it just as an academic documentary, it's not that. It's supposed to be an expression. It's supposed to go over the top. It's supposed to lean into areas that can be labeled propaganda or whatever. It's supposed to challenge critical thought. It's a film about mythology that challenges critical thought. And those that really got that, I always appreciated it. When people came up to me and said, man, I don't agree with everything in that movie, but I really appreciate the fact that you put it together. It changed my way of looking at the world. So Zeitgeist Addendum came out in 2009. That was when I actually felt like I had some responsibility, and that's when I introduced folks like John Fresco and the Venus Project and people that were forward-thinking and trying to do something different to break away from all the distortion and sickness.
Just out of curiosity, how many people here know about the Venus Project or what it is? Maybe just a very quick precis of what that is, just people don't know.
I'm sorry?
Want to give it a short?
Let's kind of argue a short one, but basically building on the work of a lot of other people in technocracy and a lot of cybernetic concepts that went in the 1930s and 40s and 50s that went on, Jock Fresco, who's passed now, he lived to be about 101 years old, which is incredible. He designed something called socio-cybernearing in the 70s, which eventually was born into the Venus Project as a more simplified name. So I think people have to be careful with what they label things. And this was very inspirational for me and many people to see that there actually was a guy running something that had a concrete set of plans that was easy to understand. I could say a lot about details that need to be expressed that currently are not being expressed by people that have been influenced by this, because there's a lot of meat that needs to be talked about in terms of how to redesign society away from capitalism and markets, where you take a true systems engineering approach and it can be done. It's just it takes a lot of explanation.
That's what the book is about.
Yes, in part. I mean, I could only do so much with the solutions. That's about a fifth of the book, because you really can't understand solutions to understand the problem. So you can, you know, people will just label you, of course. And part of the interest of the book, not to sidetrack too much, is that I wanted to get away from the duality that we deal with capitalism and socialism. It's this polarization of the ideology that has been literally stifling any type of transition outside of what is a completely outdated social model based in the 18th century. It is an inviable system. So, but we won't go on that tangent yet. So back to the Venus Project.
We will get there soon, though.
So Jock opened that door for tons of investigation, not only of myself and other people, and he should be deeply commended for that. And then Zeitgeist Moving Forward came out, and
he also had some cool sort of sci-fi ideas, like floating cities.
He was a great, brilliant designer, so he was able to visualize that world. Now, it's a little subjective. Yeah, it doesn't necessarily have to look like that. In fact, that turned people off. They say, well, I don't want to live in a cold, little round thing. But they don't understand the principles behind it, you know. So then 2011, Zeitgeist Denim built upon that, Zeitgeist Moving Forward built on that even more, and I extended the conversation to include lots of other individuals in studying human nature and systems theory and stuff like that. And that's been the final film, and I've been working on another project since then that I won't go into right now, but that book was probably, after of course the creation of the Zeitgeist Movement, and that happened in 2009, and that's the 10th year. I'm going on my way right now to Germany for the 10th annual Zeitgeist Day, so for me it's a satisfying moment to know that this organization has been around that long. To the degree it's been influential is hard to determine, because it seems like things keep going backwards on this planet. But I think seed planting is extremely important. You just never really know. You never know. That's why you have to be optimistic and keep positive and not be too cynical, even though I'm still cynical. But I'm healthily cynical. It's more of an expression of cynicism, because if you can't laugh and get angry rightfully and release what we experience, then you're just going to explode. So some people do it through comedy, and some people do it through other expressions. I say that because if anyone follows me on social media, you'll know I'm pretty much a prick to everybody. But I don't mean to be. It's just what my angle is at this point, as I'm frustrated. So anyway, I can keep rambling this. Movement, 10 years, and now the book, and now another film, which I'm very excited about, another film trilogy, which is live action, and that's where all my focus is right now.
Is the new film related to this new book, or is it totally separate?
It is. It's based on the book, but it's a completely artistic-driven film. It's not just a documentary. Mm-hmm. It's how do I describe it? It's like a avant-garde mixed genre piece where different scenes happen, and it unfolds both in an academic sense, but also in a highly abstract sense. In order to sneak behind people's ego, what I've learned about that book and just giving lectures around the world for 10 years and talking and writing and so on is that you can only communicate relevant academic information and expect people to absorb it so far. You have to do something different. That's why the arts are so important. That's why Zeitgeist 1, being the artistic piece that it is, still resonates more than anything today in terms of the trilogy, even though it's almost... I didn't say it's least important, but there's something to be said for allowing people to reach their own conclusions, to give them that Rorschach, if you will. But if it's carefully tempered, people are much more inclined to drop their ego and to jump on board of rational things if it's presented in a way that doesn't threaten them, or I should say, doesn't feel like it's imposing upon them. So if that makes sense, this film is designed as a series of vignettes, which has a linear through line against a live action film, but it's also very abstract, and I'll just leave it at that because it's very hard to describe.
So yeah, let's talk about the new book a bit. So what was the basic thing that led you to want to write this book?
Because a publisher asked me. And in the midst, I wrote a book before that. It was a joint thing called The Zeitgeist Movement Defined, which was just about a treatment on the movement. So I had experience doing that. But I'm not a natural writer. I have a lot of admiration for the prolific writers that can just whip that stuff out. That book was requested. I was like, okay, so I put my film production on hold. I couldn't dismiss the opportunity to have something actually in print on a certain publishing level. You know, self-publishing is one thing. If you have a publisher behind you, you get a whole lot more exposure. You're taken more seriously by the media and so on, as unfortunate as that is. But that's the world we live in terms of status. So when I sat down in my production studio, which is a big green screen studio about the size of this, and I had to sit there in one spot and stare at all this equipment and then write this book. It was so frustrating because it really wasn't what I wanted to do, but of course I'm glad I did it. I had to do the new book. Yeah, the book, I was really like tearing parts of my body off to write that thing. I'm not kidding. But you feel it. I spent an enormous amount of time really reducing the knowledge down. So if anyone's read it and got through it and could absorb the density of it, I think it's a great accomplishment. I'm proud of it. And I hope it's a little bit before its time because, you know, a lot of these things need to be talked about. And I think will be, as you've pointed out in your literature, we're waiting for a more vulnerable period where people will open up.
Yeah. And so a lot of the book is kind of making an analysis and critique of the economic system, and also kind of like the, you know, kind of cultural ideology that surrounds the economic system that makes it feel so kind of indomitable or impervious or invulnerable to change. You want to talk about that aspect of it a bit?
Well, sure, as far as the cultural issue, that's probably our biggest barrier. So you have a big feedback loop in society where we're born into it, we watch our parents struggle with money, we feel like jobs are our identity. I was just having this conversation earlier, like, oh, so what do you do? That question that comes up. And most people don't want to do what they do on this planet, unfortunately. And so all of this cultural reinforcement happens. Every moment we're forced into this antagonism with each other because we're seeking cost efficiency. We're trying to save money. We have to figure out subtle ways to feel like we're moral while in fact we actually have to screw people over and take advantage of their circumstances. It's this general antagonistic war system that becomes part of culture, becomes part of identity, and suddenly what do you have? You have President Trump. So that's an inevitability as far as I'm concerned. That's a signpost of what this culture, whether we agree with it or not, whether we think we're doing that, we all participate in this, and it's really unfortunate. In fact, I'm glad you brought that up, and not to be negative, but if there's any single thing that will stop this, it's not the elites or any kind of shenanigans or conspiracy, it's the general population that they're too invested. And the more technology advances, the feedback loop strengthens, because people today have more than they've ever had, even though it's still a system of social oppression. So people don't want to lose their cell phones that make pancakes, in the words of George Carlin. They have so much more material luxury in general that they're afraid to be politically active. They don't want their name to be printed on the internet so their employers will find them and berate them or fire them or never hire them because they're seen as a radical. So this is the real serious issue. I mean, I don't know. The answer to that is some kind of deeper cultural awakening. And I think, frankly, not to jump to the end, there's going to have to be a new kind of society. If there's enough time before complete ecological Armageddon, the advancement of technology will allow for some country or some group of people to go off the grid and have high efficiency and create a new example. And that's kind of what I'm figuring is going to have to happen, because within the general scope of what's happening, you're not going to see the relevant changes that are required. It's depressing to say that. I don't mean to be negative. But that, if you really look clearly, that's what the picture paints.
One of the things that I personally appreciated in the book, and it's a conversation that I have in many circuits that I travel in, whether it's Summit or whether with the people who created this incredible environment, is this idea that, you know, we could have a transformation within capitalism that would be like green capitalism, impact investment, that we can, you know, liberate the productive forces of the market to bring about the types of changes that we need on the planet. And one thing I appreciated about the book was you kind of, you know, knocked down those ideas, and I think it's important to, you know, at least have that discussion.
Yeah. I don't discourage the green intent, the sentiment of entrepreneurs or just anything that wants to do something that's more sustainable. But without recognizing that the system is fundamentally flawed and outdated, without recognizing the fact that it's not a viable system, what I mean by that word is that for a system to be viable, it has to have what's called a proper requisite variety, which means it has to take into account the proper factors that make it work as an autonomous system without the need for external controls. That's a little technical, I apologize for that, but I think if I plant that seed, you guys can go look that up. But what that means in more layman's terms is, for example, this system, the system of markets, being established, the Neolithic Revolution 12,000 years ago, agriculture, suddenly people start to trade, specialization, everything worked okay. It was still bad and oppressive, it created slavery, but the ecological crisis never came to fruition because we couldn't damage the environment as bad as we do now. We didn't have the productive capacity to do so. And it's the biggest revelation for the system flaw on that level because the system simply disregards the environment entirely. There's absolute, like look what's happening in America. The EPA is being head by a guy that doesn't believe basically in global warming. Look at the trade tariff wars. Look at everything that's ecologically destructive in terms of the fact that the system, if it was to respect ecology, the system would grind down and economic growth would basically come to a halt. Does that make sense? You can't have an infinite growth society on a finite planet and market capitalism assumes infinite growth at all times. It has to. It's all about exploiting resources and exploiting people, and the system of exploitation can't identify that problem. So no matter how you work it, no matter how well-meaning or intentioned a company is, they're still going to be in competition with other companies that are less intended, and those companies will probably undercut them, and you'll have a few wealthy people that can say, oh, I bought this green coat. It wasn't made from slave labor, or chocolate that wasn't made from slave labor, or any kind of textile, and they pay more money for that, which gives them an economic disadvantage against companies that aren't doing that, which means they're not going to really prevail. That's why you really don't see the prevalence of extremely sustainable economic industries anywhere. Not really. I mean, there could be, but that kind of efficiency is too expensive, effectively. Make sense? Yeah.
And you also talk about how, which I think I also talked about it in my book, how, yeah, like there's overproduction is built into the system, right? Like you talked about how there's 235 billion cars in the US, but the average car is used less than 5% of the time. So really we need like 30 million cars that we can all share.
Yeah, which hopefully as a general consequence of efficiency and technology, which is the only thing we have going for us, by the way, the term ephemeralization by Buckminster Fuller, remember that term, more with less. The more we advance technology, which isn't to be confused with the incentives of markets and capitalism, I can't stand it when people make that distinction. Oh, capitalism made your cell phone. No, science and human ingenuity made the cell phone. Capitalism sent it into distribution. Within that environment, and again, hopefully Uber will do that with the automated car system where it's just stupid for them to be multiple cars and people don't own cars anymore. That's a possibility. But as you point out, it's not economically efficient for that because in this system, everyone should own one of everything to keep economic growth going. The more you stop buying, the more jobs are lost and so on. And that's the way the system flows.
Another argument that many people make in their defense of capitalism as like the inevitable or only possible kind of outcome for human evolution is that it's built in our nature to be competitive and acquisitive and so on. And one thing that I appreciated in the book, which is something that I've also reflected on in my work, is that actually for 99% of human history, we lived in tribal societies, nomadic societies that didn't have, you know, the same types of values. Do you want to talk about that?
Absolutely. It's an unfortunate, it's a proximal cultural assumption, meaning that people think what they see around them and the way people behave are the only ways people can behave. And with a brain of 50 billion neurons and trillions of connections, on one level, point being is that neurochemistry and neuroscience proves that there are many other ways the brain can be wired, for one. And then the empirical evidence being that, again, 99% of human history didn't have money or markets, egalitarian societies. It took a kind of geographical determinism, again, upon the Neolithic Revolution, to create different incentives and motivations, what seemed like progress. You know, some of my anthropologists argue it was one of the worst mistakes we ever made. Because what is progress? Progress has to be happiness. It can't be the idea that, oh, suddenly you don't have to do something, unless, of course, it's an extremely arduous, painful thing. The people in the hunter-gatherer societies had more free time. They had a very different familial relationship, very great luxury in the sense of not personal belongings, but in the sense of community and things that, you know, there's no certain forms of sickness, psychopathology, anyway. All that research is out there that these societies were effectively much healthier.
I guess one argument is used that they had a shorter lifespan.
That's not true.
Yeah,
that's been disproven by a lot of people. The reason that statistic is there, by the way, just to point out, there is they did have high infant mortality.
Right.
And you average that in, yes, it looks like the lifespans are shorter. But they've gone back and found, you know, people that have lived to be 90 years old from that period in the archaeological evidence. Now, that might not be the norm. You know, there's other things. Obviously, progress can be measured in a lot of different ways. But going back to your point, that assumption of human nature is probably the only argument that seems to still stand the test of time, because any type of technical approach, when you dismiss all the propaganda that, oh, anything that isn't capitalistic must be tyrannically socialistic and lead to tyranny and Hitler and all of that, that's such a strong propaganda that people are still stuck in that world. And the evidence on all levels of science shows that it's just nonsense. Even Darwin talked about the importance of collaboration not the origins, but in other writings. Yeah, he probably did as well.
And kind of, you know, that competition was less important than cooperation,
right?
Even in species evolution.
Yeah, your fitness is defined by how well you're working, not by how well you dominate. That's preposterous. So.
And actually, I was thinking also, I noticed in the book a number of times you brought up Martin Luther King, mm-hmm. and today is, I think, the 50th anniversary of his death. There's a big kind of march going on in Harlem right now. Maybe I was curious if you could talk a little bit about how his ideas entered into the new book.
To me, he was the greatest organic intellectual in the sense that he didn't have a formal education, he was self-educated. And he's such a great model for intellectual aesthetics, if you will. His communication patterns, and while he did maintain superstitious beliefs, he drew out of his Christian beliefs everything that was good. Like it was always, it's kind of like the way my grandfather views Christianity, because he's Christian. He doesn't see it in the superstitious light, he sees it as a sense of values. And of course, it's like a Rorschach block. You know, people can pick what they want. Just look at any religion and the conflicts that happen between that. I don't mean a sidetrack, but it goes to show the personality, really, of what you're projecting into a religion. And King's use of that was very, very, was very, very important. I bring that up to you, like, oh, Peter, you're an atheist. Why do you like a Christian? Which is a preposterous assumption, because there are plenty of people that have great spiritual beliefs, that have great things to contribute, and that inspiration shouldn't be antagonized just because it might be something that didn't happen or so on. Going back to like Zeitgeist Part 1, you know, which I still get hate mail for. So what I think King's ultimate contribution is his evolution. So I've read a great deal of his work, and he starts off with the core civil rights issues, and then he slowly expands and starts to get more systemic. Structuralism. He was the first to really highlight the point that, there's no reason for there to be any kind of segregation in the sense of isolation to create power. So he wasn't against, say, the Black Power movement, but he recognized its flaw. You can't have groups re-isolating themselves to gain independence if it's going to create ego again and cause more antagonism. It has to be integration in general. You can't have that type of duality of thinking, which we still have that problem today. We have a very agitated civil and human rights community. Everyone seems like in their own group, whatever group that is. I'm not a fan of groups at all, as you might imagine. Everyone seems to be going out for themselves, and it's just really unfortunate. And he was against that. He was over that. And I always thought that was a secret thing that no one really picked up on. But in terms of, like, you know, historical perspectives, he set in motion the idea that after the Civil War, racism being a social construct, by the way, it's not something that was invented, it's not something that it happened when someone went over and got black slaves, brought them here, and then suddenly it was all because, not suddenly, sorry, let me just pause a moment. It was when these folks were taken and abused for economic reasons, and then after that, race was codified in law, and the poor whites of America were put against the poor blacks for jobs. And that's the origin of all this. And he talked about that. And that's something you never hear about anymore. When people talk about racism, they never go back to this stuff. And it's really important to understand that, because the power loves it when everyone's fighting amongst themselves. And I don't say power in the sense of some ethereal, you know, group of people that sit there and dominate. We're all influencing this power structure by our participation, but there are still, you know, the wealthy 1% and so on, the business elite, the people that live in a completely different world than the general population, and they maintain very dictatorial control in general, country by country, and the best thing for them and the best thing to keep everything in chaos and at bay and have no social change is infighting amongst all the groups of society. And that's the divide and conquer that, of course, doesn't talk about enough either. So I can say a lot of things about King, but I don't want to ramble on too much.
What's your favorite quote from him?
What's my favorite quote from King? I'd have to paraphrase it because it would be so long. Most of them are so long. Oh, you're putting me on the spot. Hold on, let me think here. My brain's flashing. It's the one about, capitalism assumes individuality, I'm paraphrasing, assumes a visual individuality and no unity and collective interest, while socialism assumes no individuality and assumes only collective interest. The truth of the future of the human species will be a fusion of the two. So he immediately cuts to the core of this duality and polarity that keeps people divided and can't think clearly. So, yeah.
I want to maybe talk a little bit more about why the sort of market system is so unreformable from your perspective, mm-hmm. and then talk about your vision of what the alternative would look like, which you lay out in the last fifth of the book, and then also a little bit about how we would maybe get there from here, because it seems like such a difficult leap. But first of all, before getting into all that, I was curious, because you mentioned that you're an atheist. This is a community that's like kind of assemblage, has a lot of people who are interested in kind of a new form of mystical or esoteric investigation, consciousness investigation, using all sorts of different means. And I guess I'm first of all just curious, if you're an atheist, which I assume means you believe that this life is it after we die, that
atheist, agnostic, they go together.
Okay.
Because you don't want to pretend.
What's animating your kind of moral passion then? I mean, is it just the sense that you know this is a wrong? We could do better than this. I mean, where is it coming from?
Good question. So you implicitly state a moral relationship to religion, which is interesting.
Well, I see spirituality and religion as very, very different.
Very good. Okay. Well, we're referring to an atheist. When I say atheist, doesn't mean unnecessarily spiritual in the sense of seeing connection. Okay. Well, spirituality is connection. It's how you understand your relationship to each other, to things, to your body, to your health, to the world, to the universe. And it's that systemic relationship. And the more you learn about that, the more it defines who you are and your role. And you can look at it mechanistically, or you can look at it. Actually, no, you have to look at it mechanistically. I think, and that sounds cold, but what I mean by that is it's the progress of understanding yourself has to be a technical process on some level. There has to be some defining features that can be deduced to a degree and associated without necessarily there being a meta level that's in completely indescribable. You know what I mean? I don't agree with kind of a metaphysical notion of the abyss of mystery. And people drawing from that, and I apologize if this sounds weird because I'm phrasing this oddly. I'm very, very pragmatic in the way I see my spiritual relationships with things, to the effect that it's an issue of causality and systemic relationships. So when I go about my work, I see it as an issue of what works and what doesn't versus what's right and what's wrong. Because if you take that view, not from your individual perspective, because I've gotten into this argument numerous times, they say, well, what's right for you might be wrong for me. But that presumes that we are somehow separate. That presumes there isn't some kind of larger architecture that's systemically relating us. And that's a profound spiritual, humbling place to be. In fact, in terms of human nature, in terms of human behavior, I think the greatest failure is people are so inclined, they're so individualistically oriented, that narcissism is so deeply bred, that they have a terrible time thinking that somehow they're not in control of their lives. When the truth is, scientifically, we're not. We're partially in control of our lives. We are a part of a large, massive integration of viable systems that started from the Big Bang and has been expanding through entropy, and we are in the midst of this at all times, scientifically proven. And if you think that way, if you can try to realize that paradox, it creates an amazing freedom, creates an amazing sense of compassion, because we see a mass murderer, or you see someone beating their wife or something, you really want to judge them. You really want, but you have to say, what are the other elements that happen here? This very rarely, do really aberrant behaviors come from people that are just normal. There's no such thing. there's always a life experience, or there's some kind of serious biological flaw, an injury. Like in the book, I use the example, and I'm sorry if I'm deviating slightly, of the individual that shot those folks in the 1970s. Chapman, I believe his name was. He's one of the first mass murderers. And then what he literally wrote, he said, he killed his mother and his wife, and then he shot a bunch of people from a tower at the University of Texas, if I remember correctly. I might be wrong. Okay. So, and he wrote in his diary, he wrote a big note, I think it was, not his diary, that I have an autopsy after I kill myself because I've been having violent thoughts that came out of nowhere, and this isn't me. And it's like something just took control of him. And I think that isn't given the gravity in terms of our sense of compassion and hence understanding.
I think in the book you said that there was actually some kind of problem with his brain.
Yeah, there was. I'm sorry. Thank you for clarifying that. Yeah. He had a tumor in his amygdala.
Yeah.
And, excuse me, jumping too fast here. So there really, really was something pushing on a part of his brain that was causing negative reactions. So when you sit back, you think, okay, what am I, spiritually speaking? I am, on some level, an autonomous system, a viable autonomous system. Yet, on another level, I am a product of a larger order culture. On another level, I'm a product of the eon of evolution that has generated my biology. And I'm a product of intermediary things, I say that's the long-term view, but intermediary in the sense of short-term, that there are things that could happen to me, like I could go outside right now and be violently assaulted, and that would change my behavior most likely for the rest of my life. There's very good reason to believe that, medically, based on my constitution or anybody's. That kind of complex awareness, to me, is the most spiritually profound, and it allows for tremendous ponderance, it allows for tremendous sense of identity, creating values. That's why I can't sit back and watch what's happening in the world, because this is me. This is me that's doing all this. And I don't mean that in the metaphysical sense. I mean, I'm a part of this, and I have the control on some level to change it, because I have to be a part of it, and I have to experience it. And we get so cold, and we get so bankrupt, where people can't do that anymore. The apathy is widespread today. So, how many people, back to the system of markets, it reinforces that narcissistic, individual, self-guiding, that's what I'm looking for. It reinforces that self-preservation, where you're constantly having to remind yourself that you're out for yourself. Oh, I gotta make money for my family, myself. I gotta pay for this bill. You're always being pulled away from the fact that you're in an interconnected system-related environment. So my goal is to see a new system emerge that takes that into account. So a new social system will be one that's actually designed based on modern scientific understandings of this nature. And if that could be set in motion, a whole new level of human existence, I think, could flourish far beyond what I think this culture could even fathom. Does that make sense?
Absolutely.
A little abstract.
Absolutely,
there.
Yeah. Makes sense, everybody following?
If anybody has any questions, we can do that too.
Yeah, let's just go a little bit further, then we'll open up to questions.
Okay.
Let's talk about the kind of alternative, which you lay out in the last part of the book. And you have, I think, a five-point
yeah.
program, in a way, or you know. Yeah.
So in the interest of transition from this old, dated, horrible socioeconomic model that's premised in a very ancient period of time that is completely unconnected to all the things that are causing the most strife, meaning it can't resolve it. It's unconnected in the sense that it can't recognize it. We know this in words like market externality. A market externality is like poverty. Poverty is inevitable in a system like this to one degree or another. It's an externality just like an oil tanker that corrupts and spills oil in the ocean. That's considered also a market externality because the market doesn't account for it. Pollution and all those things are secondary. They have to be compensated for by other means. So within that framework of understanding the flaws of this system, how it doesn't have proper integrity, the question becomes, well, what are the components of a system that would maintain basically a kind of homeostasis in and of itself, meaning that it's self-regulating, meaning that it takes into account all the modern notions that we have. And rather than go into a deep treaty, I broke it down into five basic transitions. And each of them are synergetic, though, and they all work together. So
maybe to be clear, it's good to contrast them to what we have now.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
So if I can remember them all. No. So automation, of course, is where we're heading as a species in terms of labor. And it's amazing. The most caustic thing, the most divided, war-generating, human antagonist-creating thing, antagonism-creating thing, has been exploitation of labor. It's the source of slavery. Slavery, historically, it's the source of countless abuses today. We have more slaves technically in the world today than any time in human history, based on UN standards. People being paid virtually nothing, just exploiting vulnerability.
For prison labor in the U.S.
Exactly. And plus just general exploitation of people that are vulnerable. And that's a part of the system. That's one of the driving forces of cost efficiency, as they call it. So automation of labor is not something that we should be worried about, like, well, they're going to take our jobs. We should say, no, we've got to accelerate this as fast as humanly possible. We need to get all the major technical institutions, MIT, to make systems research and to figure out how to automate virtually everything. And the rest of it is taken up by what we know as just your basic household economy. When you have the awareness that you actually live in a society and it's your home, it's not just your home and the building that's your domicile. When you actually take the awareness that you are a part of this, you'll take care of it. If we can generate that awareness, that will happen, meaning that you won't automate everything.
But I mean, you know, I guess from the conservative perspective, whatever that means these days,
yeah.
Automation is seen as the big threat because, you know, I mean, like the largest workforce in the U.S., people know what it is. It's truck drivers. There's like 3.5 million truck drivers. That's one of the only jobs. If you only have a high school education, you can still get paid $60,000-$70,000 a year. And, you know, if those trucks become automated, that's 3.5 million people out of work. That's just one. Or, you know, grocery, you know, attendants, store attendants. So, you know, what would we do with all of these people? I mean, that seems to be, and their fear of losing these jobs is what's motivating voting for people like Trump.
Which is so unfortunate because their fear is of something that's been system generated. It's not a fear, it shouldn't be a fear. It's not recognizing something that is an amazing natural advent of human ingenuity. So the whole idea of monotonous labor and, you know, I've been so corrupted in the sense of my disgust. Like, I can't even go into a restaurant without feeling awkward because I can't stand the idea of anyone walking up to me and waiting on me. To me, it's just atrocious that this life, the most magnificent evolutionary creation, the human body, the most complex system in the universe, has been reduced to this. Now, that's a phase of human development. We've had to do that, but now it's time to phase it out. And yeah, hopefully we can get past that, which means you have to have some kind of compensating mechanisms, which there's plenty of things we could talk about, like universal basic income, which is being pitched logically by, you know, Elon Musk and lots of people. So that's become fairly
common. So you're basically arguing, as I talked about in How Soon Is Now, my book, Oscar Wilde wrote this book of The Soul of Man Under Socialism.
Uh-huh.
And over 100 years ago, he was like, we need automation to, you know, get rid of drudgery and free people to explore what he talked about as cultivated leisure, or have the opportunity to really, you know, explore their unique individuality, their unique essence.
Yeah, and even worse is people have become so bankrupt that I've even talked to people that they don't even know what they would do.
Yeah.
Like, you know, that childlike curiosity has just been stolen from them. That's why people, when they retire, they often die soon after, you know, all those statistics. I just think it's... something's happened, but anyway, that's another conversation.
So automation is something that instead of being afraid of, we should be like, okay, let's go for it. Let's liberate humanity.
Absolutely.
But we better have a plan for all those people, you know, before we do that.
Which means other systems are required, and that's a lot of things that can be talked about in terms of that. I mean, for example, we have way too much variety in the technical term. We have way too much variance in this society because of the competing corporations. The process of competition might generate innovation. It has, obviously, even though you can argue what the real roots of it are in terms of science and technology, investigation and mental acuity and epistemology, but it has done that as a process, but it's also created enormous waste. Like, everyone's duplicating everything in competition with each other, you know, whether it's a phone or a car company or a computer company or anything. And you can easily reduce all of that complexity and maybe it's so much more satisfying too, and obviously more sustainable.
So let's go to the second point then. Automation is one.
I'll jump to that. It's access. So right now we have a proprietary culture, property culture. We have a property culture that hoards. We're so used to this idea of having stuff. When going back to your car example, you know, automated car systems, it becomes inefficient to own a car if you just need access to it at certain points. Therefore, you share it. You need access. So access is important. Property is a burden. Property is inefficient. Property doesn't have the cyclical relationship of turnover that access could. and we wouldn't produce as much waste. So we're dumping all this electronic waste in China and on these islands. It's just stunning. Anyway, that's a side tangent. So access, we create a system of sharing.
How would that work? For instance, people are not only attached to their cars and their boats.
I think they're attached to ideas within them. Like, I have friends like, well, I like driving my cars. I like listening to music. Well, you know, there's other ways you can listen to music. I hate driving. I love living in New York. So everyone has different values. I think they cultivate in different ways. And if someone wants to experience the thrill of a car, that can be provided in a different way.
Well, I was thinking of houses and property.
I think, you know, certain things are so stationary. Land and housing, there are ways to work around that. They'd be applied differently than, to say, you know, access to a computer or access to an automobile or any general smaller item. That could be done through distribution centers, and everything is returned back. It's a zero waste system, because when you have that type of efficiency in a society, it would be localized, by the way, which gets to another point. I'll get to touch upon that. It's part of the fifth. That means that you finally reinvigorate city systems where you're not having access in this kind of global environment in the same way. You have access within the city system, and if you go into a different city system, the access changes. So you have access to what's there. Does that make sense? It makes it more simple to manage in terms of systems. Again, a lot can be said on that as far as the architecture of how to arrange that.
So we've got the shift from labor to automation, the shift from property to access.
And I'll say one more thing about access, though. Remember the hunter-gatherer societies? Why did they have the egalitarian culture? Because they didn't have the geographical determinism that generated all of this fear and ownership and land and need to secure things and so on. If you had an access society in the future, even in the sense of homes or apartments, first of all, no one is bogged down to one place because they need a job, and that's another level of it. So there's no reason for anyone to stay in one place. I think the value system of a home is generated by the fact that over the course of countless generations, people have been forced, because of their job, because they have to drive somewhere, to stay in one place. I think that would be alleviated, and eventually you'd have access to, it's almost like an Airbnb that's free, that's open, and people can move around. Through automated systems, things can be taken
care of. Couch surfing.
Yeah. But you see my point. So even the housing thing, I think, I would love to just, I think most people say they like to travel, right? Most people prefer that.
Well, apparently we were all nomadic, originally as tribal people. That's the way they would live. You know.
I think that would change culture and values too. So anyway, the third thing, I'll just jump to localization, since I already brought that up. We obviously have all this globalization, which on one level it's argued that, well, it unifies the world, it makes it more common heritage in the sense of we're all connected. But the truth is, it's just a system of labor and resource exploitation, and it has invented such great levels of complexity that it's mind-numbing. Unnecessary and efficient complexity
on one level. The other level, it's created a kind of monoculturalization, like a lot of local cultures which had really distinct traditions and crafts traditions and spiritual traditions have been flattened or decimated.
Definitely, that's a good contrast. When I refer to complexity, I'm referring to just the motion of everything. Like the average plate of food you people eat travels about 1,500 to 2,000 miles.
People know that, by the way, just out of curiosity.
That's preposterous. I mean, that's crazy. I mean, just from a... Anyway, so you localize, you reinvigorate cities. Gandhi talked about this. He was really opposed to mass industrial development, and he said, we have to have integrity in cities just for the sake of community. It helps reduce corruption. So what you envision eventually, as he put it, were oceanic circles that overlap. So imagine New York City being redesigned where it's self-contained, where all the access and resources and industry, vertical farms are producing food. You've reduced the complexity of major forms of production. All the factories are local. It can be done. You just wipe out all the banks, you know, remove all the bank buildings and put really efficient factories. You don't need any more paper pushers. So that's an important, on multiple levels. I'm being very futuristic with what I just said. But the very idea of localization needs to be reinvigorated, not only from an efficiency standpoint, so that you don't have all this waste of energy, but also for a cultural change, because people are just so divided that the sense of community has been lost, I think.
So we've got automation,
access, localization. And the next one is open source. Open source meaning the sharing of knowledge as opposed to proprietary development. It is the foundation of everything that has progressed us as intellectual species, is the sharing of information generation after generation. In fact, some would argue that our DNA needed to get smarter because it couldn't form fast enough, so it produced our brain, which produced our prefrontal cortex, which gave us an incredible capacity to think and create essentially intellectually, and then created the society. Now we all share knowledge together, both laterally, like right now, or through generational time. So we now have this group mind, this cosmic intelligence, so to speak, this species intelligence, and that needs to be harnessed more efficiently to create more progress that's actually real. So if you took away all the cell phone companies and you got, instead of all their boardrooms trying to, you know, figure out what the next invention is that will lure you to buy their phone, they open source the entire thing. They open source it, and everyone out there that's been learning programming and engineering, which is a course developing field and should be more of a focus than, say, banking and business in the future, they're able to contribute to this and, say, an online platform like CAD or computer-aided engineering. I envision at some point pure open source where people can go into the digital realm and they can actually modify, change all of everybody else's ideas, and a certain type of consensus can be generated through fundamental AI. It's not even that difficult to put together in terms of what will work and what isn't. It weeds itself out, and suddenly you end up with literally the most intelligent, most efficient, most sustainable phone that is possible on the planet at that given point in time, only to be revised by the group mind.
And it's even edible.
Yeah. It actually makes pancakes.
Many people would say that, I guess I'm curious, because would there, in this imagined future you're thinking about, you know, would there be people at different levels of, you know, value? Like, would some people have more, I mean, is it totally egalitarian in terms of, like, is proprietary systems, copyright law, you know, is you know, that's created Bill Gates's fortune, right? And,
right.
You know, Mark Zuckerberg's fortune. They're able to build on the, you know, the commons, like, let's say, the internet was created by, you know, the Department of Defense using tax money to be a distributed system that would protect our information in relationship to a nuclear or potential war or whatever, you know, and then these people figured out how to, in a sense, privatize that common property and were able to create these, you know, maybe vast amounts of wealth and so on, and then decide what of that amount of wealth they've gained, they're going to give back in whatever way they want. In your system, would there be no wealth hoarding for people, or that sort of?
Well, that's a good question, because that's something that should be clarified overall. As I ramble on about things which seem ridiculous, because we still have a monetary system, we still live in a capitalist society. So what it argues in the book is that you basically have to start pushing out the capitalist tendency, the capitalist system, in the sense that less and less money would be needed if these types of efficient systems were put in place. If you had developed a fundamental system for access, you're wiping out, for example, billions and billions of dollars of revenue as people start sharing. Open source completely destroys the proprietary advantage of any kind of corporation. So it's built into the very notion that each step of these five steps will reduce the need for market behavior. So does that make sense? In terms of open source, though, I wanted to comment actually, I just completely lost my train of thought. Sorry. You distracted me.
Sorry about that. So wait, there's a fifth one though. We've got
So the fifth one is the what puts it all together. So all of these four things I've just mentioned, there obviously there's more that could be talked about. There are lots of subcategories that go within all of this, but you need a digital feedback system. What we call the Internet of Things right now can be expanded, where live instant communication of what's happening economically, what's happening with human activity can actually be understood, can actually be systemically processed, so we know what we're doing. So as I said earlier, the system of capitalism doesn't have a way to adjust itself when unsustainable patterns emerge. So we continue to destroy rainforests, we continue to exploit minerals beyond recouping them, we continue to abuse all sorts of different resources because we're not only not tracking it in any kind of real way, we just don't care. So this system would have built into it an actual way of feeding back. In system analysis, you have two things. You have positive feedback, which is an amplification thing, which means like the banking system, so they make more and more money. So more and more money, positive feedback. You keep printing money, it goes in the system. And eventually what happens, well, the whole thing crashes, and you have what you've had numerous times throughout history.
Or they just keep making more money.
Well, they do that eventually, yes. but it has to correct. See, that what happens in that case, the negative feedback, which is actually a good thing, it says negative, but it's a good process, it corrects what's happening with the positive feedback. And this system doesn't have that. Our economic system doesn't have hardly anything like that except major catastrophes and horrible social advents. that people finally step up. I mean, even like protests could be considered a kind of negative feedback to the system to try to get the system to do something different or correct certain behavior. So in this kind of what I call digitized network feedback system, which you can do globally, you start locally. So a whole city like New York has this mechanism built in. You're all connected to it. Your behavior is a part of the knowledge of what's happening. And I hate to say it in a way, people think, well, I'm going to be tracked. Is this Big Brother? Well, the only reason we have the tendency of Big Brother is because we have a completely competitive society that has been developing and codifying power for numerous generations. I think the paranoia needs to be subsided. If you think tracking information about what your behavior is doing is a bad thing, that kind of hyper-privacy view doesn't apply to this. So I just want to clarify that. I get that argument all the time. So long story short, you create this network of feedback that enables you to actually know what you're doing. Imagine that. Imagine actually knowing what we're doing as a species in terms of all the effects we have on the planet and the effects we might have on a given region. You create a homeostasis in the economic system, which will create homeostasis in society, which will have numerous other side effects too, such as the elimination of war, elimination of most social strife, and so on. And obviously, as you talk about in your book, the pending ecological apocalypse, you know, there's nothing positive on any level, any trajectory. Every single life support system is in decline. There's literally, any peer review, there's not one positive trend of the past 100 years. It was okay until about the Industrial Revolution, but we got our little play kit, we got all our things playing in the sand, and we exploited, and like children, we've been completely immature, and we're on the edge of the point of no return. The only thing we have, by the way, the only thing that's going to save that is the race of ephemeralization. The only thing, if maybe
we'll... Let's slow down and explain, yeah, sure, that, explain the concept of ephemeralization. That was from Buckminster Fuller, who's one of my great heroes, yeah, the design scientist of the 20th century.
So the tendency, as a, for computers, an easy example, the computer has been, excuse me, the computer 50, 60 years ago cost a fortune. It took up a whole room. It generated enormous power. The lights would dim in the city. Now the computer in your phone is about 100, probably 1,000 times more powerful, in fact. So the general move of technological efficiency goes from big and complex to small, light, simple. And that is the most powerful trend of our entire society. That is the saving grace. That is what has created what we call progress. Our ability, eventually you're going to have a world of nothingness, but it's going to have everything if it's allowed to come to fruition. And I'm sure there are certain things that we can't even fathom, just as I'm sure 1,000 years ago.
Another trend that's maybe equally important is the zero margin cost.
That's Jeremy Rifkin coined that term in a more direct way. That all that says is, well, if you have a machine that you pay $1,000 for, and that machine doesn't require much to maintain, this is more of a theory, but it makes perfect sense. I mean, it happens, but obviously there's more complications when it comes to dealing with a machine. But so you have a $1,000 machine. The first good it produces is $1,000, right? The second good the machine produces is $500. The third good is $250, all the way down to where you're producing goods that cost virtually nothing because the technology is so efficient and strong and durable. And that's an important
thing. That's certainly the case for digital reproduction of,
yeah,
music or films.
Definitely.
Or books. And now our system has to create these kind of artificial obstructions to maintain a profit.
I feel so bad for my musician friends because, you know, file sharing pretty much ruined the music industry from a profit standpoint, which is why you have to pay $400 to see a concert now. But that's a natural conflict of the system. You know, people are going to do that. And this, rather than, again, fight it, there should be a whole different level where people are like, well, if we can't make money off of this because it's so easy to share, we need to figure out a way to make it make the money monetary incentive less interest. And that's what this whole system proposal that I'm putting forward is. So there's all these clashes happening that are really apparent. Like violent clashes, automation's a violent clash. That's probably one of the most...
And in a sense, some of these things, as you mentioned in the book, are actually happening or trying to happen.
Yeah.
I think the tendencies are there.
Absolutely. Well, Internet of Things is like...
Sharing economy.
Yep, sharing economy. And, you know, open source is a big movement, which is great. Of course, it's being fought tooth and nail. Localization, people are trying to revitalize. There's a lot of talk about that too. I think that's going to eventually happen. It's going to eventually be realized even in this system that having all of this energy and waste happened, and with the rise, of course, of ephemeralization, more with less, you're going to be able to have a facility the size of this building producing 1,000 times more variety than what we've had prior, meaning instead of building computers, the facility will build computers and phones and cars and all sorts of other types of electronics or complex machinery, because the production will be that efficient, again, going back to ephemeralization. So does that make sense? You can eventually establish, probably, in the theory of it, you could have one machine that pretty much produces everything through nanotechnology. That's the fantasy version, but it doesn't have to go that far. So, you know, molecular engineering would be the final step.
What about, like, degrowth in the short term? Would we need to kind of degrow or de-develop?
I think from an ecological standpoint, I don't see any other choice. I mean, therein lies the great nail in the coffin. We have a whole society based upon growth to fuel jobs and so on, not to mention competitive economies and all that stuff. And yet that is exactly the problem that's destroying the world around us ecologically. So you're going to have some kind of shift. That's the conundrum. Like, how do you deal with that? How do you deal with such a massive clash in the values of the planet or the values of what's required to be sustainable and the entire value system of this type of economy? And that, if there's anything people walk away with, think about that, because that's why we're stuck. As we're all participating in this, trying to make money, but we have to, obviously. But yet, at the same time, we are all agents of the demise of ourselves. If population keeps growing, and if our behavior just gets more and more amplified. And again, that positive feedback. Oh, it's just one massive positive feedback gyration spiraling out of control.
Yeah,
it's not
correct. Let's pause for a second and celebrate the alternative, because people look a little sad all of a sudden.
Oh, sorry. Well, you
said before that it could be a system that would be like give us so much more capacity and joy if we could make this transition.
Well, yeah, no, absolutely. Well, that's what I'm trying to encourage.
Yeah, yeah.
Not to shame you all and to make you feel too unmotivated. But that therein lies the great issue and why, like, the Zeitgeist movement was.
What happens to government in this new model? I mean,
Well, let's think about the origins of government. Government was created in tandem with the capitalistic tendency. After the Neolithic Revolution, it made sense that you had to have regulation of a system that basically led and gravitated towards corruption. So there's no mystery that if you leave people to their devices and they're put in a vulnerable position, a good percentage of them will gravitate towards being corrupt, and they'll steal and screw people over. That's just a part of the system. So what do you have to have? You have to have regulation. So you build upon regulation. Suddenly you have to regulate other things that are related to industry. And I'd say 95% of the laws on the books are really economically related one way or another. Even when you're talking about violent crime, all more often than not, the deprivation that's generated that crime has had economic roots. Like, a family doesn't have money.
As Rousseau talked about how the origin of inequality was private property.
Exactly, yeah.
So you're saying that government would somehow be wither away a little bit? Or, you know,
I wouldn't use that. I'd say it would transform into something that's basically a real system. And it's hard to talk about this, because if you don't study systems engineering, since in nature, everyone's familiar with fractal geometry and self-similarity and stuff like that, and like the vortex of the Milky Way galaxy is so similar, obviously, the vortexes we create in a hurricane or the water going down your toilet. It's that entropic recursion, they call it. Recursion meaning it's self-similar. A recursive property is like you marry someone, have children, they marry someone, have children. It's the dolls and dolls and dolls and dolls phenomenon. It's self-similarity, and it's basically a complicated notion of self-reference. And nature does this, and that's its fundamental organizing pattern. That's a big conversation. It's really a mathematical conversation. But if you look at the rise of simplicity to complexity, it's done through this process at multiple levels of recursion. And if we recognize that, just like we recognize the law of gravity, we see that there are actually system organization, system patterns, like in the human body, that reveal the way our society should be organized, that reveal the viable system, as people like Stafford Beard called it. He studied the human body, and he established an entire model, and he applied it, actually, in multiple instances with great success, emulating this kind of biomimicry, emulating what nature is doing. And so what is nature doing in our nervous system? It's communicating in different ways as semi-autonomous organs, and it communicates in an environment, and all of that put together creates you. And that's another fundamental phenomenon of systems. It's worth pointing out that you can't reduce systems to some of their parts, because parts don't have properties the system produces. And that's a profound thing to think about which of course completely negates almost the whole of the way we would deduce and we reason and categorize. We see things as separate, a tree and a glass, when it's really a system property amongst in something that's larger. So our whole process of thought and reductionism is thrown out the window with this type of comprehension. So I had to throw that in there. But so you take that kind of model, and it's out there, it's been experimented. It's actually the entire basis of computers, ultimately. They have these feedback systems. They're kinds of organisms. And you premise the whole of organization of society upon that. And if you do that in concert with sustainability principles, the laws of nature that all of those five things we've just talked about reflect, that we're getting in harmony, we're forming homeostasis. A true viable system, like your body, has homeostasis. It self-corrects. Corrects your blood pressure. It corrects when you have a temperature.
It still eventually croaks.
It does, but it gets absorbed by other systems. So it gets absorbed into the planetary system, and it continues that recursion process. So within that is the answer to how we organize our society in the future. It will be done through technological means. It won't be done through electing representatives or the old notions of democracy. If you're in line with nature truly, the democratic ideal isn't have half the gravity that we think it does now, because no one's in war with each other anymore. Different conflicts can be expressed in different ways with different forms of resolution that don't require this type of overarching legal system. I say this in a very optimistic way. I think if the things I just talked about in the book were put in motion, the five things, you'd have a very reduced sense of government, a very reduced number of laws, because none of that stuff is being agitated anymore. And if you apply a cybernetic system, where you attach all industries on the planet, localization, you have open source, you have people building and designing and creating economic progress together, you have an abundance generating mechanism through ephemeralization and more with less, as we talked about. If all of that is set in motion, the system will equal out. And that is the government. Basically, government becomes the economic engagement, because that's really what government does, that's what it represents. Government is about dealing with things that the economy doesn't do right. In the end, that's really what it does.
So how many weeks until we get this together? So let's talk about, so that's the basic idea that Peter puts out, and like how we could transform economic systems so that it allows for justice, ecological harmony, long-term homeostasis. And obviously, we're not in that situation right now, right? So, what are the leverage points? Like, what can we do? Many people that I'm connected with right now are really fascinated with blockchain technologies and this idea that, blockchain is like another layer of the internet that could allow for, distributed autonomous systems, organizations, transparent exchanges. I mean, is there some hope there to leverage that for this type of outcome?
I think that's one technology that builds into that kind of cybernetic systems approach. I think in the securing of information, blockchain is really a kind of ephemeralization. It's cutting out a third-party process. It's able to peer-to-peer. And that's actually a beautiful phenomenon, to think that you could go peer-to-peer with technology and eliminate any kind of overarching structure. That'd be perfectly in line. For example, no more cell phone companies, because you can create mesh networks where all of our phones connect to each other directly through a mesh network. So you literally can have autonomous phones that are powered by every other phone that's in existence in the network as far as transmission, if that makes sense. So that's all profoundly amazing, that what's on the horizon. And I take blockchain as just another indication of where we're headed. All these things are slowly happening. It's a natural gravitation of our society, all these new advents, in conflict or not. We can't deny the natural gravitation.
In some sense, you're saying, which is what I talk about in my book, that it's an evolutionary process, you think?
Oh, absolutely. I think, well, here's the difference between us and other organisms. Other organisms don't have the capacity to mess themselves up. Our confusion, our development of our brain, because we've been given this gift of inquiry and self-awareness and volition, the illusion, that semi-illusion that we are autonomous beings, it's built into us as an evolutionary baggage. Because we're given this, it becomes, oh my God, hold on, my jet lag just completely destroyed me.
I think I got it. We have this curse of reflection along with the gift of it.
But your original question was?
It was way too back in the sands of time for me to recall.
Really? Damn. Hold on. He'll come to me. Yes, thank you. So, like that. So effectively, we have this great gift of consciousness, but yet we're not smart enough to know what it's going to lead to. We haven't figured things out yet. So the natural gravitation of capitalism, everything else. I use the analogy of oil and hydrocarbons. So oil and hydrocarbons, amazing. It created all the productive efficiency we saw at the turn of the 20th century, a little before that. So that was an amazing step. Without that, we wouldn't be where we are. But now what are hydrocarbons doing? They're destroying the atmosphere and effectively could be the nail in the coffin of humanity if we're not careful. So we have to move on. So there's a system evolution, as you point out. But the difference is, if we get stuck in tradition, our brains restrict us. And we codify the wrong things, unlike the other animals in our species, other animal species. We're the only ones that have this kind of ability to do that, to mess up our own natural evolution. I really believe that, you know, we could have a positive trajectory, or we could just as easily not get there because we're too distracted.
It definitely feels like things are in motion right now, like kind of a sort of rigidification or kind of a, you know, degenerative process. I mean, many people were noticing last week this Sinclair, which now owns like most of, you know, newsrooms, like most of the cities in the U.S. They're now giving people these kind of pro-Trump, all the anchors have to read the same pro-Trump editorial message, and they synced it all together. You could see that it's basically like, you know, an evil hive mind or something, you know? Yeah. And it feels like a lot of things like that are just becoming more threatening, you know?
Absolutely. Again, it's as James Gilligan, a violence researcher from Harvard, put it in thinking about nuclear war. It's like the big threat to society now is not nature. It's not the environmental threats. He's being more dated in his view. But in the broad scheme, the big threat is culture. Our biggest problem is our culture. And I think that's a profound thing to consider, and makes it increasingly daunting, because the feedback reinforcement of this system keeps people locked in to this gaming mentality, and they're out for themselves, and that narcissistic-driven interest. And so we're trapped in our own...
But let's say enough of us wake up, particularly enough of people maybe who, you know, there's on the one hand, there's like the mass public, maybe there's also people who have access to resources and capital. Then what do we do? How do we break
I can only hope that there will be the eccentrics, the outliers that do have resources that can come together and help build something new. I really believe that when you show people, you know, what the future can be in a way they can understand it, as I've tried to do in film and such and the work of the Zeitgeist Movement and so on, if they can really get it and absorb it, then they'll want it. They'll understand it naturally. There's a rational... We are rational when the ducks are in the right line and we're not being pulled. So, yes, I think...
So the compelling need would be to have some working prototypes of a new system.
There's either a digital creation of this type of organization where people could see how it works, how they engage it. So someone says, well, I want a cell phone. How do I do that? They could go into a virtual realm online and do that and see it and understand it and explain to them. The math is there. I did a lecture, and it's actually in the book. There's a series of equations that kind of outline the general structure of this new economy that's self-regulatory. And I've tried to get some mathematicians together at some point years ago to start putting this together, but I didn't have the time, and these folks needed to be paid and so on. And I think that would be the most profound step. And I think it also would be amazing for basic industry.
Think tank kind of, in a sense.
Exactly, but actually build it, though.
Yeah.
Not just theory. Mm-hmm. So when you lay it out in true technical form, and I think that would actually be great for modern corporations, give them incentive to actually care about what they're doing and their own feedback loops. Meaning, if you are in any kind of resource exploitation, we'll just use rainforests, there should be a natural stopping point in a program, or just basic reasoning, really, that says, okay, you're not going to exploit any more trees because they're not going to recover fast enough in this reason. It's over. So you have to do something different, time to figure out something new. That kind of live, real-time feedback, that's the basis of this. Dynamic equilibrium, homeostasis. That simple idea, if that could be applied and legislated into corporate America, we'd at least maybe be able to recover from the global crisis.
Do you think there's a likely kind of size? I mean, I'm thinking, for instance, I was just in Puerto Rico, where a bunch of people from the crypto world have been moving down there for tax reasons, but now there's a new movement to kind of see if they can use the blockchain technologies to kind of restart Puerto Rico and create like a new humanist model that includes like regenerative farming, renewable energy, and so on.
Yeah.
You know.
I think blockchain could be a new level, as I said before, of this type of cybernetic organization, which is a weird word, but all it means is you're mirroring what our bodies and our nervous system is actually doing in terms of systems, what nature's actually doing. And I think if a small country could do that, that would be profound. I have to think about Cuba, the embargo of Cuba. They've done so well with their limited resources.
Yeah.
It's incredible. But imagine if it was in the future. This is hypothetical. Obviously, they would be embargoed in the same way and all the communist stuff. But imagine it happened in a high technology world and the governments of the world did this. And Cuba said, well, we don't care because we can produce everything we need in high abundance right here. That's the kind of thinking, I think. Thanks to have.
Very interesting. Cool. Well, listen, I'd love to take some questions. And the easiest way to do that is to start on this side of the room and kind of make a sweep. So if you guys on this side of the room have questions, well, I just realized I probably should have spoken closer to the mic this whole time. But Mahul, did you want to have a question? So by the way, Mahul is a friend of mine who is doing a blockchain project called Circles. Essentially, the idea is to create a universal basic income using blockchain.
Thank you so much for your talk this evening. I really appreciate it, especially as a system scientist. I appreciated your references to Stafford Beer and all, you know, so. My real concern, though, is Heidegger said of cybernetics in his essay, The Question Concerning Technology. He said, cybernetics is the logical conclusion of the Aristotelian project, and that within it is like this logic of reductionism. And, you know, I'm really worried that what we need is with all these five steps that you recommend, I think those are important, but we also need a fundamental ontological revolution. You know, we need to change the way we fundamentally interact with the world.
Go on.
Yeah, so I'm just
in what sense can you expand on that?
If we look at indigenous peoples, you know, they don't look at the world as a metaphor. For example, they are the river. You know, they are the mountain. There's no separation. This sort of subject-object differentiation is kind of, in some places, vacant from their vocabulary. And what that does is change the way we interact with everything. And so I think there's a danger in the world right now in this sort of techno-utopianism that we can solve all our problems with technology.
It's not that simple. I agree. No, and I think that's a good point. I hate it when people hear all this and it ends up being reduced to some, oh, well, technology is our savior. That's not at all what's being said. In fact, it's really a structural psychology that's developed. So it's a sociological relationship. You can argue it's a chicken and egg thing. Well, if culture is this way because of these influences and it keeps making these influences, how do we get out of it? And I think that's an extremely difficult question. And I jokingly call myself a structuralist. Or because I believe in structuralism, I just like that arrogance. Begin. I like making fun of people that use isms because it's so stupid to ismize anything. But what I mean by that is I'm interested in larger order influences on the human form, on the human being, and on society itself. And when you take that view and you look at what happens in a society such as our market system, all the social psychology it generates, what that leads to, you realize that, well, the best thing we could possibly do to change the way people see each other and the world is to change the structure they're inside of. So I believe in that. And I think it will happen either by piecemeal, as we've talked about, or maybe in some place, some locale, some country off the grid, so to speak, literally, some new culture can be established to set new standards. But you're right about the ontological crisis, that's for sure. Yeah.
Cool. Who's got a question right here?
I'm very interested in this discussion of government because it's very interesting what you were talking about, and I'm trying to like bring it down to like real practical terms.
Yeah.
Let's say off the coast of Maine, a big group of people want to do a wind farm, and then another group of people say, no, we don't want our view soiled by a wind farm. You need some kind of body to...
It would be local. You'd have a local body that looks at various levels. It's really rational. First, you have the economic appeal. Is there a necessity for what's being done? Is it actually something that society will benefit from, or is it just some addition? So if Donald Trump wants to build a tower towering over a Central Park, masking with shadows everything, that would be extremely inefficient. Most people wouldn't want that. It had no utility because the tower doesn't do anything. It doesn't serve a role. So I think when you have a purpose that society agrees upon, which I think is that, I'm sorry, go on.
Well, in this particular case, there's conflicting values.
Yeah.
One group of people wants a nice, pristine horizon, and another group of people need that energy. And so there has to be some kind of governmental group or some kind of organization to figure that out.
Yeah, I'm not saying that suddenly the engagement of people in a political context disappears. I think there are numerous instances that over the time the need for that will grow smaller. But for example, another example would be, where does someone put a site they want to build? How does someone decide that? As anything, that should be a community decision, should it not? That should reach consensus, a rational consensus, not just a one person, one vote type thing, at least not at the beginning. There should be some kind of way of engaging intellectually, and those platforms, I think, can be established. That's grossly missing.
What do you think about the argument around the rights of nature? Apparently in Ecuador, they sort of wrote a new constitution where they talked about, you know, sort of establishing rights for nature, almost as if nature was...
I think that's an abstraction. I think it's great. The gesture, the sentiment is great. I mean, doesn't it sad, though, that we'd have to even think that way? Haven't we not realized that the habitat is what supports us? You know what I mean? So I think there's a lot of appeals to stuff like that. In a system that's economically governed by homeostasis and a cybernetic systems approach, where you're actually emulating nature once again, the decisions about a lot of that stuff becomes self-evident. It becomes automatic. Does that make sense? Just like in your body. There's no debate happening in your body about what's going to be going on. There are governance things that you can make in your own mind, because your mind is a governor in your consciousness about what kind of food you eat and so on. But that becomes self-regulatory too. And I'm starting to be too abstract about it.
No, it's okay. It's just that there will be different cultures.
Yes.
And different cultures will have different values.
But I think,
and those different values, yep, will need to be argued about and fought over.
I completely agree. But
you need a government of some kind.
The difference, going back to Stafford Beer, is there'd be a reduction in variety, because you're finally getting people on the same page about what it means to exist intelligently on the planet. Are you going to have outliers? Of course. You're going to have people with mental illness? Of course. You're going to have problems where people have to interject and take hold in a policing type of way, most likely. But it'd be a very different approach, different angle of what you're talking about. But I completely agree with you. But I think the reduction in requisite variety, as they call it, will be such that you'll find far less conflict than you see today. The majority, you have to compare it to today. It's not that suddenly everything changes and it's magically different. It's all reduced in the problems. That's the hope. I think that's progress, right? You just reduce the problems. Keep reducing them and figuring out why you can reduce them. And I think you'll eventually have at least a homogeneous culture that shares fundamentally the same values. Like in Native American cultures. Like, you know, you go back and look at the writings. They had a fundamental belief in nature, and they understood it and they respected it. And they shared that value. And they might be in conflict with Western cultures, but who's actually correct? You can quantify that. Obviously, in Native American cultures, in terms of their respect for nature, they are more correct. They understood homeostasis naturally, intuitively. So there is a way to bridge it, and there's a way to value it, and basically a way to quantify it, and where if this argument was to come arise, it's not just this person believes this person believes this, and suddenly they're equal. That's something I get so sick of hearing about. Now, sorry, that sounds mean, but their opinions are not equal. There are ways to value opinions and that relate to something. There has to be a relationship. So I don't want to give an example of that, actually. Yeah. I'm going to be too much of a tangent. But.
Cool. Let's take another question. How about a woman? Anybody from the female gender want to jump in with even like anything? No? Okay. I know it's a very male kind of vibe in this particular kind of conversation. But I also want to mention that, you know, part of what we want to do with the assemblage going forward is really use it as a laboratory for these types of discussions and even experimenting with implementing different things. And we're going to try to make that a regular aspect, kind of interrogating what the new paradigm would be with ideas like Peter's talking about and other provocations and interventions, and then see what we can use this community to create over time.
Hey, thanks to both you guys for being here. Peter, I have a hypothetical question. So it's some unspecified point in the future. There's a colony on Mars. There's about 10,000 people on it, and it's growing. And Elon Musk calls you up. He says, Peter, I want you to be the director of culture design on this Mars colony. And I have a one-way ticket for you. Do you go?
A one-way ticket?
Huh? Yeah, you're never coming back.
If that proposal was actually made in reality, I think I'd have to. If that was anything like that came to fruition. But you know, the truth, though, is if you were able to start new, Mars is a bad example, because Mars has a very difficult terrain. You have to build, obviously, all sorts of infrastructure to make any life there.
You can create your own nature, though.
In a fanciful sense, but you're still bound by pretty rough conditions, as compared to Earth. That's all. As compared to a planet that had that perfect Goldilocks condition
not too far from the sun, not too close, and so on. I will say on a different level, I really appreciate Stephen Hawking's view that humanity needs to continue and we got to get the hell off this planet before we finally kill each other and ourselves, ultimately. But I think that's a terrible point of focus. So I'm kind of disappointed with these experimental ideas because they're not focusing on what really needs to be resolved. I wish all the energy and resources spent by some of these great entrepreneurs in the technology realm would focus on the problems locally before trying to be so ambitious. You know, I don't care about living on Mars. You know, do you? I'd rather see things work out here.
Earth is pretty cool.
I'm sure it'd be a unique landscape, unique vistas.
Well, then you could genetically modify us to breathe sulfur.
There you go.
Hi. I had a question regarding education. What could we start doing right now with the new generations to start creating that consciousness or start preparing them for this type of homogeneous humanity, if you call it that way?
In like a university setting, it's because of the drive for money, most of the really great ventures or disciplines are not really sought after in the way they should, such as programming and engineering and investigations of nature on a deeper level, not just the compartmentalized, you know, this is chemistry, this is biology, it all has to be merged together. There's no unified science out there. That's the kind of stuff that needs to be taught to kids.
Well, exactly. What happened here? That was my second question, really more for, you know, young children, 3, 4, you know, 2, 3, 4 years old, and those very formative
absolutely
years.
I think kids should have their hands in dirt. I think they should understand the natural processes of nature. I think it's an abomination that parents are giving their kids cell phones at like 7 years old. Like, if you don't understand, like, imagine the future where someone doesn't even know how a plant grows. I can imagine someone actually being born in this modern generation not having any idea because it's so removed. So hence they're not in connection with anything fundamental. So this stuff that I talk about, I think, is ultimately fundamental. It's things that have been lost. It's mirroring what's already been in existence in terms of nature. And if the values could be created in children at the youngest possible age, I think they would carry it forward if they're not too corrupted by this social psychology generated over time as they inch into survival. Because there's the catch-22. Because the more you live in this society, the more you become an adult, the more you're inclined, obviously, to survive and make money. All of that natural sense, that holistic sense, that sense of integrity and relationship gets lost. It's just individual me. I'm fighting for survival.
So you're almost saying that we'd have to really, you know, transform the market system.
I don't see any way out of. We can't, just like the green economy.
Yeah.
Within a system like this, education and people's values are not going to change, or at least education in the sense of what they pursue most intently, which is making money. It's not going to change because the forces of survival are too strong. Without maybe the one thing can make alleviation. If we had universal basic income, which might happen, which a double-edged sword, but at least at that point, it might give families sustenance that can give more time, or give a child sustenance at a younger age, whenever they receive it, to give more time to not feel so stressed about their survival. So the stress of survival driven by the system corrupts our ability to develop more proper epistemological or ontological awarenesses. It's really tragic, actually. I think it goes back to a spiritual sense as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, more questions? Questions? No? Oh, we got one over here. Over here.
Hey, thanks. Thanks, guys, for the talk. I really enjoyed your book and still haven't read the appendix yet, but I'm getting there. Getting back to technology, it's clear that this transition to out of this system into a better system is going to take place over, it has to take place over several generations to sort of unbrainwash everything.
Or it could take place in a forward-thinking society right now if they're able to break off the grid of the global dynamic, effectively, like a Cuba
right.
or
and
North
we
Korea.
We clearly, when you look at the ecological indicators, we don't have several generations
that's
to
true.
Make transformative.
Yeah.
I mean, many people say that even the next 10 years are really critical. You know, probably at this point we're not going to you know, it doesn't look like we're going to go in a new direction. You know, maybe we're going to be forced to experience increasing catastrophes that will then bring about, you know, enough of a change or a realization, a collective realization that the system can't continue as is, which will then open the possibility for models like Peter's. But it's definitely not a several generation process when we look at what's happening with species extinction and CO2 and everything else.
Well, yeah, in terms of getting off, you know, realizing that the way we're living in terms of, you know, the destruction of the environment, like that'll all have to get worse before it gets better, obviously. But I think that in terms of, like, overcoming the narcissism and overcoming the, you know, drive for competition and moving towards the values of the tribal societies that you were talking about, that might go a bit deeper and might take a bit more time.
Possibly.
So in that time, going back to technology, I'm wondering, you know, how do we prevent, like, the increase of technology from getting into the wrong hands and trying to co-opt the...
Well, if you haven't noticed, almost all of the great technology has been co-opted since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution by the war machine. All the funding that goes into universities for advanced technology, now AI, is being financed by the Pentagon. And it's sickening. In fact, that's why you'll notice that a lot of the things we have as modern technology, like a microwave, that was actually invented on a submarine. I think it was a nuclear submarine. Yeah, internet. So the government's inclusion of technology is for better or for worse, because there have been some positive things, but at the end of the day, the incentives are wrong. The war machine is the worst co-op of all this. So if you're talking about, like, terrorism and so on, well, yeah, it's inevitability that at this point in time, especially with the incredible tension. You know, in terms of what you talked about, Daniel, you know, what's going to happen by 2050 is you're going to have areas drying out, you're going to have areas flooding. You're going to have a refugee crisis globally, mostly centered around the global south and the Middle East. Yeah, mostly. And then all those people are going to go somewhere. And there's going to be a goddamn mess because they're just going to start piling into Western.
It's already not so good.
Yeah, and what's going to happen? Well, totally. And what's going to happen with that? You're going to have people building big walls, if not concentration camps, so to speak, places where they're going to be put in temporary houses and so on. And it's just going to be nasty.
Wei has their Chinese artist has a new film out called Human Flow. On the refugee crisis,
it's
a very profound film. I was really moved by it. But it already shows how extreme it is and how little reporting there is. And then also he humanizes the people in the refugee camps in a very beautiful way. And it just reminds you that, you know, that we're all in the same boat, really. Yeah.
And this trajectory has to somehow be stifled quickly. Yeah. Something has to happen. But in terms of culture, you know, it's almost a convenience to think about culture. But right now it's biosocial pressures. Right now we have physical forces impending, beating us down for all of our terrible behavior, our childish behavior, our immature behavior since the Industrial Revolution specifically, and now is the time for some type of correction to occur. And how that happens exactly, well, we could speculate all day, and I'm, you know, fascinated by it.
Let's take another question here. Thanks, guys, for your questions. I know it can be hard with so much information.
Hi, thank you. Based on where we are today, do you feel like any of the movements that have sparked over the last couple of years, I mean, most recently, obviously, the March for Our Lives and Black Lives Matter and all the other women's rights, everything that's come about recently, do you think there's any hope, I guess?
Well, they all have an effect, but it's the degree of that effect is suspect. I mean, let's think about any of the existing pop movements. Obviously, the gun issue, but what's really underneath that? It's an incredibly unequal society in America that has generated a whole new public health crisis of anger and alienation. And statistically, there'll be outliers in this kind of developmental process. And in where we've ended up in America as this experiment, really, this forbidden experiment in inequality and a hyper individualistic market capitalism, you will have statistically people that would go out and just flip out and kill people, like the woman that shot people at YouTube because they took her money away from her YouTube videos and so on, thought that they were censoring her. This is a new level of public health sickness. So that has to be recognized until the system is recognized. When people talk about women's rights, well, that is obviously an issue that goes back a long ways in patriarchal society that has a lot of different roots. But what's really the driving mechanism now? Economics, major driving mechanism for underpaying, or to set up NDAs where people like Weinstein can go out and abuse people that are so vulnerable that they don't want to fight back, and they need their job, they need their career. All this confluence that comes into that. So it's an abusive, exploitative machine, and women, I think, are the easiest targets, and have been, obviously, going back.
So do you think it's cyclical? It's just going to keep going round and round?
I think you're going to have certain levels of progress. I think they'll, just like in Martin Luther King's time, you know, they had civil rights movements, they got people to vote, and they were working on other levels, and of course he was shot before the Poor People's Campaign, the most important campaign that could have happened, it could have actually changed things in America. That was going to create a new economic bill of rights. He wanted universal basic income then. But look, it got shut down because that's what the system does. It's like a feedback system that lets it go a little bit far. It accommodates these changes because, really, frankly, because of technology. There's less pressure and scarcity in society, and people are more easily controlled now through social media and the news.
Psychopharmacology.
Yeah, absolutely. And hence, there's less of a need for that type of rigid oppression that used to be there before. So slavery being replaced by automation and advancement technology, suddenly don't have as much slavery anymore. But so point being, you'll have a little bit of progress, but nothing in those movements that will ever overcome the true issue. In fact,
what would be great would be if the people who are involved with those movements recognize that it was actually the economic system that's like the underpinning of this whole thing.
Yeah.
Because that's, I mean, I basically agree with him that that's the level where we're going to have to innovate and reinvent.
Did anybody here watch the Bernie Sanders Inequality Town Hall? You know, first of all, it wasn't on any news channel because news is supported by marketing and advertising. They don't want anything that even resembles anything that could be called socialist or anything that would take away the power of private enterprise. So it's on the internet, and I watched it. Millions of people did, which is great. They don't mention anything about the natural incentives of the market economy. And I was horrified by that. And Martin Sanders is huge. He had a huge movement in a literal sense. People mobilized behind him. And yet he won't come after the actual system at its core, at least publicly. I've never heard him do it. And that's unfortunate. So it goes to show the feedback system and the fear. Because I think deep down he probably believes those things. He knows the system's flawed in that sense. In the same sense of Martin Luther King, because he's very much a disciple of King as well. He uses a lot of his rhetoric and so on. But he doesn't go that length because I think he thinks he won't be taken seriously politically, which is probably true. It's like they're barely taken seriously politically right now anyway in the American Congress, Elizabeth Warren, Sanders, any of those folks. So therein lies another feedback system that's keeping things at bay.
But, you know, it also, you know, is the case that sometimes things look really terrible, then there's a breakthrough.
Right.
You know, I mean, look at the surprise of, like, the fall of the Berlin Wall in 1989, which no think tanks had predicted. The idea that, you know, human beings would rise up and take down the wall without war or nuclear exchanges or whatever wasn't even on the table. And then it just happened. You know, so, but it's very important then to get this collective realization out around what the system is doing. And it's very difficult because people are now entrained to be extremely shallow and narcissistically self-centered in a very like shallow, short-term way. You know, the amount of energy it takes to, you know, plod through a book like Peter's or mine is more than most people are generating on a mental level right now. And somehow we have to hope that people kind of up that wattage because you really need to have that kind of grounding and talk about these things, well with people.
Yeah. I'll definitely just conclude by saying the next movement has to be an economic change movement. That's where it has to come from.
Hi. It's actually harder to speak in a microphone. Thank you for making such awesome movies and your book. I found it tremendously inspiring. And why ask people to change this aspect of them? Wouldn't it be easier to understand this flawed nature, our ego, et cetera, and try to work within that?
I'm not sure I understand.
Okay. It was hard to read your book. I put it down many times. I actually got very depressed, but I went through it. I mean, you present the truth, and it's hard to absorb all of that sometimes. I also work in marketing, so I understand that. Sometimes it's easy to make an emotional appeal to have people understand, to change their behavior. And I don't necessarily think people always operate from a logical perspective. And I appreciate that you're very structured in the way you present things. And actually, I, I think it was tremendously well researched, and I don't understand how you put so much wonderful thought and effort behind it. So thank you so much for doing that.
Thank you. So as far as your question, are you saying that there should be more of an internal revolution
Don't negate the power of an emotional appeal versus just a logical.
Oh, believe me,
appeal.
That's why the arts are so important, and why I still stand by that. And I've helped curate a Zeitgeist Media Festival in Los Angeles for many years, and I always am big in touch with musicians and artists and so on. And my new film, as I said, is very artistically driven. So I have on one side the book, very academic, and then my new expression will be extremely abstract. But I just want to reinforce the structural element, though, man. As long as this thing is in place, all of our psychology gets polluted by our short-term interest at the expense of long-term destruction.
Question behind here. Hey, Wiley.
Hey, Dan.
Hello.
So this will resonate with you, Daniel, but it's a question for both of you. What are some thoughts on just how talking about indigenous cultures and societies, about how revisionist history has played into our sort of current thinking, and what are some of the things that might we benefit from past civilizations' advancements in technology that we may not even have known about today, but are replicating in our own way today? What are some general thoughts around how that is something that we're constantly discovering more and more about life on Earth, as it previously existed, and we still don't know the origin of ourselves, and we still don't know so much about these societies. So as we start to learn more...
Which societies exactly?
For instance, they just found thousands of buildings of Mayan civilization that they previously didn't know existed, using different types of imaging technology, right? We're finding stuff on the bottom of the ocean all the time. As we start, some of the Dead Sea Scrolls were just recently found again, right? So, as we start to unlock more of our past and we start to sort of layer that against revisionist history as we know it today,
right?
What are some of those insights that can be drawn from that, and maybe the things that they got wrong or the things they got right?
That's a big question. Well, first, I like the idea of the word or phrase revisionist history. I just want to point out quickly that if you look at history, it's always being whitewashed, so to speak, by the values of contemporary society. History just keeps changing. And that's an unfortunate phenomenon, and the fact that it's very hard to trust what we hear about history. That's just an aside, though. I take that in the context of Dr. Martin Luther King. When I was in high school, never did I hear about his Poor People's Campaign. Never did I hear about anything of his objections to capitalism and markets and competition. Never did they say anything about universal basic income. It's all just, he helped this group of people achieve this type of civil rights. And that's whitewashing of history, because it's inconvenient to have those things pointed out. People naturally blinker it out because it goes against the values of their society. So a writer, would say, well, this is just socialist. That's been disproven. We don't even know annotate. That's not important. So, there's a word for that. It's called a climate of opinion. That was a term by Carl Becker. In terms of the history of civilizations, the anthropological research is extremely important. I think if it wasn't for the discovery or the knowledge of pre-agricultural societies and those that still exist in the Amazon with tremendous variety and difference in behavior, it gives us at least an element of as you said earlier, pointed out earlier, of debunking the fixed human nature argument. There's enormous human variability out there, for one. So that's one thing I take away from it. In terms of organization, there's a lot of things that could be said. There was one culture that had a really unique... I hate to say socialist again, but had an egalitarian society post-agriculture that was, I'm sorry, I can't remember right now. I wish I could, because it was a great example of where you could actually see as they excavated and they were able to, they basically was a big community. They were able to generate against the grain of the tendencies, the geographical determinism of the agricultural revolution, they were able to make a more egalitarian society. And I think Native American cultures are probably another example of that. These are anomalies, by the way, because if you look at the whole of this anthropologically, all the societies have been highly competitive, restrictive, dominance-oriented. And then suddenly, Native American cultures. They had lush environments in the Americas. They established a different respect, of course, for nature as opposed to exploiting. And they had a very, remember the Christopher Columbus stuff, that horrible diary where he talks about going to the Americas, and he says, well, we showed them a sword and they cut their hand, and they didn't know what it was. They gave us all these treats and welcomed us into their home. And then he says in the next sentence, we can wipe these people out with 200 men. Yeah. So that's the geographical determinism of the dominance in Christopher Columbus's mind, going against what was an anomalous creation, which was the Native American cultures and other indigenous cultures.
But I've been lucky enough personally to visit some of these cultures, or you know, do retreats with them, like the Kogi and the Arawak people in Colombia,
right,
or the Sequoia in Ecuador. And you know, I actually think that these cultures had, you know, a profoundly different sense of, you know, what was important, and valued, you know, areas that we would talk about as you know, psychic or mystical experiences and explorations of consciousness that I believe will be part of our human future once we get past this, you know, inflection point, if we get past it. That actually is part of the type of engagement that we'll want to have in the future. Will be more understanding what those cultures were about and how they, you know, use their capacity. I mean, we've tended to denigrate those cultures. In some ways, they might have been more advanced than us in the depth of their exploration of consciousness.
You also talk about shamanism, and you talk about the use of drugs in these communities, and it's been known and it's been researched, and mushrooms and LSD and ayahuasca and lots of these psychedelic drugs, they have been reported and studied to generate ego loss in a very clinical way, and that's a profound therapy. I don't advocate that because we're not in a mature enough society where I don't advocate people just going out and doing drugs, because you have to understand the conditions, you have to understand parts of your nature. I think people that have terrible genetic tendencies towards, say, schizophrenia or certain types of mental illness should be very careful around those things. But there are cultures that have been working a great deal, ayahuasca and so on, and I think that ego loss that's associated with these types of substances can have an effect. So that's something also to learn from these indigenous cultures.
And then also there's a variety, if we look at these indigenous cultures around the world, in terms of how they handled areas like, you know, intimate life, like sexual relationships. There are cultures where women had a total sexual freedom, you know, and so it shows us that this model that we have, you know, is just one that's developed due to certain historical and environmental circumstances, that actually we could reinvent it, you know, in other ways that would be just as much in accord with human nature, which is very capacious.
I'd also add that there's a great body of research that compares, it's in the book as well, desert cultures to lush rainforest cultures. The example of the chimp and the bonobo, separate from what you're saying, but as a genetic lineage, our brethren of the chimps and the bonobos that have the closest genetic line to humans, at some point thousands of years ago, millions of years ago, chimps and bonobos, I think it was one of the rivers in Africa, divided them, and they were the same species. The chimps ended up in very restricted desert regions where they'd fight, and the bonobos ended up in really lush rainforest regions, and they developed a completely different social architecture, more matriarchal, lots of sex instead of violence, and as opposed to the chimps, which have much higher propensity for violence. And of course, anthropologists would always go the biased route and look at the chimps and compare them to humans and say, well, these are chimps, this is what we are. You know, this is how they justify war and everything else. And then the bonobos were left into the subtext of history.
Right.
Yeah.
Danny?
Thank you.
My question is around proactive versus reactive action. You know, there's a lot of movements, there's a lot of things going on, people trying to push for this positive change. A lot of times it doesn't go very far. The powers of be have a lot of control over how much change they're going to allow to happen. We can force change and try to push awareness, but it seems like the biggest catalyst for change is when people are actually impacted by things. They become reactive, right? So look at the gun control situation, or even actually a better example lately is the trade war, right? The biggest impact of the trade war is happening to the Trump supporters who voted for it. So
they won't know that, though.
Well, but they're going to feel
it. I don't know what you're saying.
But you feel it, right? Yeah. And it's
what you're referring to is a biosocial pressure, that's what's called.
Right. And, you know, to a certain extent, I feel like nothing is more effective, and you gave a great example of, you know, the automation, right? Mm-hmm. If we can accelerate automation, people will feel the impact of that automation faster.
Absolutely.
And accelerate this whole thing. So does it make sense to keep fighting it, or should we just let it go and accelerate?
That's a hard question. Well, as we talked about, you know, those transitions I talked about, access, open source, all those things are trajectory, they're in trajectory all by themselves because of the natural force of the efficiency they create. But at the same time, we're faced with the complete barrier of ecological Armageddon coupled with the class inequality that is just as corrosive and will only be amplified by the ecological crisis as it continues. So there's a conundrum.
I mean, in a way, I personally, like, you know, I'm kind of weirdly happy when Donald Trump is like deregulating the financial markets again, because it's like, okay, guy, like, bring it on. Like, let's have 2008 times 10. Let's see the, you know, because it might only be faced with the collapse of this fiat system that we would have to innovate like mad to construct the next thing. But we have to have these ideas of the fact that there can be a next thing, what that thing could feel like, you know, in place. So if that opportunity kind of emerges, then we can say, well, it doesn't have to be authoritarianism. You know, here's an open source, you know, multi-dimensional currency platform with a liquid democracy attached to it that helps you build local economies.
Well, I think that's why having those solutions in place, even though they may not be getting very far right now, having the solution in place gives people a place to go once they realize it, right? Otherwise, if you don't have solutions out there, you can tell people all you want to, you know, conserve electricity, but until they've experienced, you know, a power outage on their island, you know, and
I know,
think about renewables.
Exactly.
Yeah. I'd say on one level, what you say is a little bit on a kind of a cynical level, but it happens to be kind of true. I like to believe that people are fairly rational agents. They can go about learning and adjust properly. But at the same time, again, all the pressures of reinforcement, people have to learn, unfortunately, the hard way all too often.
Got other questions?
There's whatever left to.
What's going on, Peter? It's good to see you again.
Justin, right?
Yep.
Hey, good to see you.
So in regards to competition, we talk about competition and collaboration. We need a collaborative society, not a competitive one. People, I think one of the biggest misperceptions that people have when they're introduced to this train of thought is that they think this new paradigm, this new economic model that we're proposing is going to be one that's completely void of competition. And obviously, I think there is a competitive impulse that humans have, people want to be recognized for their achievements, and so forth. So I was wondering if you could speak a bit about the distinction between healthy forms of competition, sport, competition in regards to creative ingenuity and so forth, as opposed to economic competition, resource competition.
That's a complicated question. You know, I think I stand on a more extreme state. I don't like to see any type of competition between people that ends up with a belittling of the losing party. And that seems to be a natural gravitation. It just reinforces that same antagonism. Even when you see guys in like a boxing ring and they hug afterwards, one of those guys has a hurt ego. One of those guys might go home and beat the shit out of his wife, you know, as has happened numerous times in the UFC world, for example. So, you know, it's not
What about jazz? Or you have like John Coltrane or Thelonious Monk and a band of awesome musicians, but he's, you know, there's somebody there who's still like Monk or Coltrane.
You consider it a competitive culture?
No, it's not. But I mean, there is a way that people are, you know, they have a talent. They're showing off.
Oh, sure.
Demonstrating, you know, genius in a way, you know.
Yeah, I agree with that correlation. I mean, people that have great skill and talent, they become inspiring. I think, in, say, in athletics, we'll just use that example. It could be inspiring and motivating. But I think sometimes what it's really reinforcing ends up being more negative than positive.
I remember actually there was a fun story about they brought cricket to some, like, islands and like off New Guinea or maybe something, and the tribal people learned cricket, but their version of cricket when the English people went away and then came back is they would play cricket until the score was equal, and then they would stop. So they might have to play for days and days, and then finally once the score was equal, they'd be like, okay, we're good.
There's another side angle to that. That's really good. There's actually, I heard about that recently. There's another example that I can't think of, but where people are literally playing to equal. That's the game, which is great poetically. In terms of what competition does, though, is very important in the sense of your mirror neurons and learning. What really happens in the advancement of people engaging in some type of game is they're able to experience through their brain's mechanism of mirror neurons, experience vicariously the abilities of others, and they're able to adapt faster. I noticed this explicitly as a musician in a classical music environment. If I was around teachers or musicians that were of really high level, it was incredible how rapidly I would move to a higher level versus being in a much more subpar environment where people weren't as skilled.
It's a motivator. It drives.
But deeper than that, I think there's actually a connection of the brain where humans are actually designed evolutionarily to learn from each other. We're designed, we react better when we learn from each other. There's just something about, you know, I'm sure there's other, there probably could be, you know, endocrinological, I can't say that, endocrinological things that come into play. What? Not chronological. Endo, say it for me. I can't talk.
Endocrinical, I don't know.
fuck it. So point being is that there's something out there that connects people on that level, and it's been unfortunately turned into something that I think reinforces, as you know, the worst competitive, you know, general characteristic of our society. When people go to football games, they don't sit there and say, wow, those teams did really good together. They say, I want this team to win. They have their team.
Yeah, so it's reinforced that.
Yeah, another nice story from a tribal society I always really liked was these documentarians. I mean, it's a little different, but I think it's the similar kind of idea. Wanted to make a film about a bunch of Aboriginals in Australia. But instead of just making a film about them, they decided to do it collaboratively. So they showed them all these different documentaries and films. They asked them, what did they want? And the tribe looked at all the films. They were like, okay, like, we want the whole tribe to be in every shot. You know, we don't want there to be any close-ups on anybody. So they actually shot the film that way, where the whole it's a wide angle, and the whole tribe is in every shot. So it's just a different mentality.
You know? But to just conclude that question, I would just say that if you have a society that isn't premised in such a hideously competitive way as its foundation, I think whatever happens in the future of people being gaming with each other will be just so much more pleasant. It won't have that top-level psychological reinforcement that I'm engaging in this act and that my entire self-worth is representative here because this is the way I have to engage in the real world. You know what I mean?
And I've seen you know, your perspective on MMA and the UFC and the way that kind of reinforces.
Again, it's not a one-sided thing. I mean, I think if people have skills, if two people want to get in a ring and beat each other up, I mean, I guess that's good for them if it rewards them, but it's far more deep than that. What made that culmination is far deeper than just the voluntary activity. It's a sociological pathology, and, you know, even as skilled as they are, you appreciate the skill, I don't appreciate the idea of the game at all. In fact, that goes for pretty much all sports in general.
I was going to call out to this side of the room, this distant corner, if anybody, like Elizabeth holding her hat, wants to have a question or...
Anyway. No, you have to. I lost my voice, so I don't have anything prepared. But for a lot of the time that I've heard you speak, I've been very annoyed because of how original I used to think that I was. But Peter has been saying literally. I just came from a meeting where I was saying almost everything verbatim in the order you just said it, of basically the future of all these things, and I was applying it to a blockchain project that I was kind of discussing their go-to-market strategy and their long-term strategy, and it's about supply chain management, and specifically even about truckers losing their jobs and about how we're not going to have as much, there's going to be a high concentration of ownership of capital, if any, unless everything is tokenized. And it's going to be much more about access, and it's, in this particular example, giving the truck drivers now the reins to take some ownership into stock of that shared access kind of infrastructure that they can start planning for the next 5, 10, 20 years of the effect of those things. So now I guess I'm just going to hand people books when they ask me my opinion about the future of technology and markets. So thanks.
Well, kudos. Oh, yes. Kudos for that work. Maybe we were separated at birth or something. I don't know. Yeah.
Anybody else in that corner while she's back there? David Sauvage? No? Okay. Well, any other questions on this side, or should we wind up? We got one over here? Yeah. Run, Danny, run. We don't have robots yet, so we're stuck with you.
Thanks so much. I had a question for both of you in regards to your thoughts on the future of food production. And I know you speak about localization and vertical farming and things, and there's obviously companies like Memphis Meats and soy lent, but how do we change the culture around food, which currently is so unsustainable? And also, I kind of feel like the technology around food, like the technology isn't really like as far along as I feel like it should be in terms of creating like more sustainable food options.
I'll go first. I would say the industry is amazingly unsustainable. It's not just due to globalization, but you're right. And whether humanity likes it or not, the harvesting of animal products has to be eroded and replaced by some type of substitute, which I think can actually be done in Germany. They had the first grown meat in the lab, and it was actually the cost had been reduced substantially. Now that, you know, sparks rightful fears, and we've already got the GMO semi-catastrophe, where it's this mystery of illnesses now being generated through all of this. And of course, science is not paying any attention to it, so everyone that talks about that is, oh, it's all been debunked and so on. But clearly, we have all sorts of physiological pathologies that are occurring that have not occurred before. So the GMO fear, the fear of modification, that's an important consideration. But I do think you can basically in vitro start to produce meat, for example. And then you establish other more technological means, of course, localized. And effectively, if we can get away from this horrible and mostly inhumane process of animal agriculture, I think we'd all be much better off in the long run, not to mention, obviously, the contribution to climate change and so on.
Yeah, I guess the question is then how to, you know, orchestrate that as you know, one idea I had was I was thinking about if you could almost, you know, have like shared social agreements, like social contracts that people would join. You know, maybe you could, you know, create like campaigns, media campaigns where, you know, with media stars, you know, like, you know, Russell Brand or whatever, Moby, who would try to get a million people to agree to give up, you know, meat for a year. Then if you did that, you could show all the value that would have for reducing like deforestation and antibiotics in the soil and all that kind of stuff. Maybe there'd be somewhere like that. What's that?
Moby just opened a restaurant in the East Village. But
oh, you opened another one? He had 1 year ago.
Yeah, yeah. But I feel like you could have probably done more to actually, like, I don't know, it's vegan, obviously, but to kind of, I don't know, use that as a platform to kind of promote, I don't know, sustainability and veganism.
But I think we'd have to do some kind of big media awareness campaign. I mean, in a way, you know, in this culture, in China, if the government decides that everybody's going to be vegetarian, they'll just make that happen. It's harder to figure out how we get there in this type of society, which is so much based on free choice. But it is something, you know, 30% of the Earth's surface is animal grazing land, which is ridiculous. And the amount of, deforestation in the Amazon, like, you know, the tropical forests produce like 20% of the oxygen we breathe. So we keep losing the forests. You know, that's it's curtains, you know, so, yeah.
Is something like soy lent the answer?
What's that?
I think it could be more advanced than that. I think once molecular science gets to a safe point in terms of engineering such animal products or things that would imitate it, that's probably the more profound stage. I mean, soy is actually a very intense thing to grow.
Yeah.
It's very water intensive. It's not really as sustainable as people think it is. But so I think we're in a sense of technological salvation, the food industry needs a lot of work in order to maintain the palates of our society. I think eventually we'll mature, hopefully, and then we don't need all this ridiculous diversity. Like, most people eat the same thing all the time anyway, but yet if you look at what we actually produce, it's just obnoxious, the pointless variety of sustenance. So, anyway.
And some people feel that's like a great human advance. Like, we've never had so many tastes.
They love to go to a grocery store and see 400 boxes of cereal. And then they have two political parties.
We had one question over here. Maybe you can move towards the center so he doesn't have to run all the way. And maybe that'll be the last one, unless anybody else has a burning question. So try to end us on a positive, like, upbeat note.
Yeah, totally. Is it cool if it's feedback to that question?
Yeah, I can do it quickly.
Okay, cool. So I think... Sorry, not to, like, I think that the, like, transition to more sustainable food will be similar to, like, our transition to autonomous vehicles. So I think right now there are lots of even, like, plant-based protein solutions that can, like, mimic meat and these types of things, but I think it will just, like, be slow and gradual. Like, a few people still ride horses, so maybe in 50 years, like, a few people will still eat meat, but, like, you know, mostly we'll have transitioned to these other solutions just like some people will probably drive as hopefully. We kind of do the shift, yeah. But I think it's happening like now. Yeah. So
that was it?
Yeah, sorry, it was just okay. Quick feedback. So yeah.
Okay, one more question here. Last one.
Would you consider doing anything in politics?
I don't know what that would mean, because it's not a platform. I mean, obviously, if a politician came forward with these views, I don't think the comprehension of society is such that it would follow through yet. Personally, no, because I don't have the aptitude or patience for that. I struggle with my personal patience with this subject as it is. I can't even imagine putting myself in a position like that. But that's personal. That doesn't mean that I don't communicate the ideas and hope that people realize them in the hope to influence society. Politics is a whole different subject.
So you're like Steve Bannon. You need to find your Donald Trump.
That's a huge subject in terms of, because for me to explain that, I have to explain what the political system is today, where it came from, the feedback loops that keep it centric and loyal to the economy that we have, the way people are filtered out and abused and oppressed, and that's just a whole other subject. I mean, if there was enough support and it was clearly, you know, that people really wanted to see these types of changes, and I was put in that position, I'd be forced to by the pressure of it, but I always cringe at that.
We the people can make it happen.
Yeah, I really think that this kind of social change won't come from a single political mind or someone that represents the movement. It has to be far more grassroots than that. And then eventually, instead of having politicians, you have people that have engineered systems that have shown such efficacy with these new systems that everyone starts incorporating them absent of political interest, absent of political anything. And they might try to regulate it down like they do with blockchain and so on, but if everyone's utilizing it, and you've got it small and peer-to-peer, and you have, the network is there, and it can happen on a local level with high efficiency, then that would be the moment that would be the political revolution, because no one could stop it. Does that make sense? The idea, to me, is the evolution of this is transcending the political system and getting people to start adapting their own systems locally, and they bridge out through networks across the world eventually. And eventually, the politicians, they don't even know what's happening because they're still locked in the old paradigm.
I think we have one more question.
Yeah.
We have one more final question.
I'll make it fast, I promise. So I'm actually a music producer, and my involvement in the blockchain space is fairly new. So I was curious, as a question for Peter, considering your involvement in the content space and the music space, you know, obviously there is a huge potential application for blockchain in the content world, you know, rights management, royalties management, direct distribution, payment to artists, things like that. What do you think the tipping point will be? I've seen so many cool projects that don't seem to catch on, and then on the other side you have Spotify, who bought MediaChain, last year. So what do you think the tipping point for both artists and fans will be?
That's a hard question because I'm really not in that line of thinking. Most of my analysis has to do with structural relationships and identifying the problems, and I see basically all forms of market behavior as fundamentally problematic and unsustainable. So when you engage in blockchain in the sense of securing rights or use as different forms of distribution or securing payments or people are investing in artists, like I've heard all that stuff in terms of music, I think it's a good step, again, for the peer-to-peer relationship. I love the idea of no record companies and people just going peer-to-peer, hence, you know, the uniqueness of the internet. And if they can support themselves in doing that while setting an example of new peer-to-peer phenomenon, then that's great. But I really can't contribute much to that other than that broad view.
Cool.
Okay, thank you.
So guys, thank you so much for listening. I know it was a lot of complex ideas and information, and it's really feels really good to share these types of ideas in this space and just get them out into the circulating and you know, New York and everywhere else they might go. And I really appreciate all the hard work that Peter's been doing to think this stuff through. Frankly, I appreciate the hard work that I've also been doing to think this stuff through.
And likewise. Yeah. You've done great work yourself.
Really happy that you guys came. And listen, we're going to, as I said, we're going to have ongoing discussions and interventions in this type of area in the assemblage. And it'll be great for you guys all to stay, you know, engaged with that in the future. And thank you so much for being here with us. And let's hang out and, you know, have a smoothie or something.
Thank you all. Yeah.